Ahead on NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen.
We'll explain how NCBA is making sure rules that protect sage grouse don't jeopardize your ability to graze cattle. Plus, an update on the cattle market outlook as we head to the end of 2016.
And now, NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen with host Kevin Ochsner.
Hello and welcome to NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen. I'm Kevin Ochsner. Thanks for joining us. Well, it's election day, and no matter the result of this presidential race, there will still be many issues in Washington, D.C. that can impact our way of life. One of those issues is sage grouse. For many years now, both the NCBA and the Public Lands Council have been heavily engaged in the potential policies and regulations resulting from sage grouse conservation efforts. Those efforts led to last year's not warranted decision from the Fish and Wildlife Services, as well as some restrictive resource management plans from the Bureau of Land Management and Forest Service. Joining us from our Washington, D.C. office is Ethan Lane. He's the Executive Director of the Public Lands Council and Executive Director of Federal Lands for NCBA. Welcome, Ethan.
Pleasure to be with you.
First, as the federal government begins implementation of these resource management plans, the industry has been pushing back to ensure that producers aren't unfairly impacted. Tell us about that effort.
Well, unfortunately, that not warranted decision from the Fish and Wildlife Service last year came along with some restrictive resource management plans that are proving to be as restrictive as a listing for producers in western states that have sage grouse populations on the landscape. What we're seeing is an inappropriate focus on grazing as opposed to the real threats to the species as identified by the Fish and Wildlife Service. Those include wildfire and invasive species like cheatgrass and development. The best cure for these issues, particularly that wildfire threat, is responsible grazing. We are the absolute best remedy for those fine fuels that lead to catastrophic wildfire. And if we're applied properly, we can significantly contribute to the conservation of the greater sage grouse. Unfortunately, that's not what we're seeing with the implementation of these plans, and that's why we're focused so heavily on this issue right now. We've engaged all three branches of government, both the Congress as far as legislation to put a stop to this, as well as the court system, and direct discussions with the administration as far as how this is being implemented.
What are the prospects for some relief for producers before the end of the year?
Well, there is language in the works right now that could be part of a year-end deal. As we know, once the election takes place in November, we'll have a few-week session of Congress where lots of different priorities will be debated, and several year-end pieces of legislation, the so-called must-pass legislation like the National Defense Authorization Act, will come up for a vote. The House-passed version of NDAA has language in it that would provide producers the relief they need to continue operating for the next several years. We're actively engaged in trying to get that language into the final NDAA bill that is sent to the president's desk. Our opposition in that arena is a variety of environmental groups that are opposed to any grazing on the landscape, and a new crop of sort of phony sportsmen's groups we've seen over the last few years that pose as sportsmen's groups, but really are aligned with those radical environmental groups that we so often see. We are spending all of our resources and time trying to combat that on Capitol Hill and making sure that lawmakers have the right information so that they can make a good decision and keep producers in a productive place, both economically and as far as conservation of the sage grouse.
And what can cattle producers do to get engaged in this sage grouse issue?
They can talk to their members of Congress, they can talk to their senators, and they can let them know how important this issue is. The members of Congress on the House side have done solid work on this issue. They've ensured that language is in the House-passed version of NDAA. If you talk to members of Congress, thank them for their efforts on this issue. If you talk to your senators, give them a call and let them know that this is important language that's critical for the livestock industry and must be included in a year-end deal.
Well, thank you, Ethan, for your insights on this important topic. Every day, the NCBA staff here in Denver and in Washington, D.C. work on the issues that matter to cattle-producing families. You can help in the fight against regulatory overreach by becoming an NCBA member. Just call 1-866-USA-BEEF or go online to the website beefusa.org. Year after year, the U.S. beef industry faces significant challenges, ones that can even test the toughest producers. We asked cattlemen and women from around the country what are some of the biggest challenges they see for the industry now and into 2017.
Well, I think the biggest challenge for us right now is adjusting to a new price level. We enjoyed the run-up, and now we've got to figure out how we make things work with lower prices.
We have price as a real issue right now, and there are some special meetings going on here at Summer Conference regarding the CME, how the disconnect right now between the board prices and cash prices, and how important it is for beef producers to have some sort of risk management tool, and the CME has always been that risk management tool for us. Right now, that's not a very comfortable situation as we consider putting calves in feed yards or whatever the case is. Not sure how to use that because of the erratic market on the CME.
The biggest challenge in the cattle feeding community is probably profitability and how we're going to be sustainable. And so we have some challenges in front of us, you know, keeping our beef demand to the point where we can all be profitable in the beef community, whether you are a producer, a stocker, grower, or a finisher, or a packer, or a retailer. It's important that all of us are able to be profitable.
Being able to weather the storms of prices, consumer needs, and the weather.
Federal regulations are what's not just me, the whole industry is fighting that battle on a daily basis.
Get EPA out of our business. I mean, we all want clean streams and clean rivers and all of that. And I want to protect the land just as much as anybody else. But to have such burdensome regulations coming down at us, and every time we turn around, it's more and more and more, and it costs me more to do my business. So I think that's one thing. Get government out of it. Get it back to the state and local levels, and where we can work with people and not somebody, some bureaucrat in D.C.
Up next on Cattlemen to Cattlemen, we'll have the outlook for the cattle markets in the final months of the year, as well as the beginning of 2017. Plus, learn about a couple of great programs that are helping to develop cattle industry leaders. Don't go away. We'll be back right after this.
What does it mean to be dependable? It means you do what you say you'll do time and time again. Because performance isn't optional, and your task is essential. For over 95 years, we have proven ourselves to be the most dependable choice. That's why the cattlemen of this great nation trust Ritchie to provide fresh water on demand. Ritchie, proud to be a partner to the American cattlemen since 1921.
No storm is too powerful for New Purina Wind and Rain Storm Minerals, formulated with ultimate weather resistance. That means more minerals in the feeder and available to your cattle. Wind and Rain Storm Minerals provide more consistent intake and balanced mineral nutrition to optimize herd health and breedback rates. See the difference at your local Purina dealer or visit cattlenutrition.com. Wind and Rain Storm Minerals, another way Purina is building better cattle.
Welcome back. Cattle markets in 2016 have provided a wild and mostly disappointing ride for producers this year. So what can we expect as we head to the end of this election year? Joining us now to talk about the market outlook is Jessica Sampson, the Livestock Marketing Information Center here in Denver. Jessica, what is the outlook for cow-calf producers for the remainder of this year?
Well, I think you kind of hit the nail on the head. It's been a disappointing year, and unfortunately, that's probably going to continue out the rest of the year in terms of lower prices. If we step back and take a look at the market, we just have a larger supply of cattle, larger supply of beef cattle, more feeder cattle out in the country, more fed cattle, more beef supplies. And it's not just in the beef market, it's in all the protein markets. So if we look at total red meat production, we're actually up almost 70 million pounds last week compared to the week a year ago. And year-over-year increases in beef production account for almost half of that. So we just have a lot of protein on the market, and that pressures prices lower, unfortunately, in the beef market and the other protein sectors. So with that, you know, feeder cattle prices in the Southern Plains last week were actually 40% below year-ago numbers, and that's hard to see, that's hard to hear, and it's a tough economic environment for our producers. Fed cattle prices right now hovering around $100 per hundredweight, and just significantly lower than year ago and lower than what we all thought originally. So if we look at fourth quarter, we're moving into fourth quarter, we are forecasting continued lower prices on those feeder cattle prices. We're seeing about 25 to 30% lower than year ago, so fourth quarter of 2015. And those fed cattle prices still about 10% below year ago numbers. So unfortunately, just on these larger supplies and these price movements, we're not seeing a lot of upticks. There is some good information in the market. We had a recent cattle on feed report that's slightly bullish for the market and could support fed cattle prices into fourth quarter. We're moving into a possible seasonal increase in the cutout value with a holiday buy-up, and that could support fed cattle prices also. And that all feeds back to possibly supporting feeder cattle prices in the short term, along with those seasonal kind of normal upticks in prices we usually see. So there's some potential good news out there, but generally lower prices than year ago still.
So the one piece of good news is it's big corn crop. Tell us your perspective on that.
Right, and that is excellent news right now. So we're probably just over halfway through corn harvest right now. So according to the USDA reports, we're about 60% done with our corn harvest. Compared to last year at this time, we're about 70% done, but we're pretty much on average for being 60% done. We're looking at a record corn crop of over 15 billion bushels. Now, obviously, the corn producers aren't very happy about that because that means lower prices.
Right.
But cattle feeders, cattle producers, that's great news for us. We're looking at corn prices coming year about $3.15 a bushel. So very affordable for those cattle feeders.
Yeah.
And obviously, if the corn price is cheaper, that allows them to have more money to spend on feeder cattle.
Hopefully.
Here in the future.
That's
so
right.
Big thing to watch is, you know, if we do for some reason run into a short corn crop, very unlikely to happen in this harvest, but looking down the road, obviously those corn prices highly influence the price of feeder cattle.
So I wanted to look down the road, as you mentioned, and talk a little bit about 2017. What's your overview of the cattle markets in 2017?
Sure. You know, continued higher cattle supplies. We're still growing the cattle inventory. Obviously, these lower prices have slowed down that inventory growth, but just due to that biological nature of cattle production, it doesn't stop immediately, right? So USDA is actually expecting total cattle inventory to be up 1.4% in 2017, in January, compared to January of 2016.
Okay.
So that means more cattle still on the market. As we forecast our prices, you know, we're still forecasting lower prices, but we don't expect drops to the extent that we saw this year.
Okay.
So when we look at those prices, you know, the first half of the year, we're looking at feeder cattle prices that are more on the 10 to 15% lower year on year, as opposed to the 40% lower we're seeing this year.
Yeah.
As we move into the second quarter and then second half of 2017, we're seeing those price drops get even smaller in terms of the year-over-year changes. So looking at about 5% below year ago, moving into third quarter of 2017. Obviously, that's still pretty far away, and a lot could change if we ran into drought situations. Again, like we said, short corn crop, there's a lot of factors that can change that.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, we're not expecting another huge year-on-year drop.
So I'll put you on the spot.
Sure.
What's your best advice for cattle producers as we enter 2017?
That's a great question, and one we've definitely been asked a lot. You know, I like to say out front that those cattle producers know their operations better than anyone, so I'm not going to sit here and tell them what to do. And there is good news in the market, like we've talked about. Export numbers are up. The economy's still growing. There's some good bright spots, but we look into 2017, and, you know, we're in that time of year where cow-calf producers and stockers are making a lot of production decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Do they retain their calves? Do they sell them now?
Mm-hmm.
And we want to look at that crystal ball. So what we see in the market right now are actually calves are being slightly undervalued, and what that tells producers is to hold on to them and sell them to the feedlots at a heavier weight as opposed to the lighter weight.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's the signal to everyone, right? So when you're making these marketing decisions, you have to say, well, if I'm doing this, we probably have a lot of other producers out there doing this, and that could bunch up animals down the road when you sell them. But retained ownership this year really is a viable option to look at. Mm-hmm. You need to have a very sharp pencil, though. You need to understand your cost of production, sure. feeding the animals that extra time if you do any value-added programs, preconditioning, mm-hmm. forward contracting. You need to know what those cost you, mm-hmm. and you need to know down the road what price you can take for those animals. Okay. So on our forecast, when we're saying first quarter, we're coming in looking at those yearling prices being about 10 to 15% lower. Think of what you got for those cattle last year. Does that work for these programs you're thinking of doing in retained ownership? Don't mean to be, you know, all doom and gloom. Like I said, there are some bright spots. Cheap corn prices, sure. exports are doing well, but it's going to take a real sharp pencil here for the next couple years still.
That's great advice. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for having me.
Yes. Now, if you'd like more information on input cost, weather outlooks, and cattle prices, you can visit the Livestock Marketing Information Center's website. That's lmic.info. As we come to the end of a tough election season, it seems one of the striking needs for our nation is for strong, responsible leadership. But it's not only in the political arena where leadership is important. It's every bit as critical on our farms and ranches and within our own beef industry. In fact, there are a number of efforts underway to train, encourage, and develop leaders within the beef cattle industry, as Russell Nemitz reports.
With the beef industry rapidly changing, identifying and educating young leaders to help guide and strengthen the industry has never been so important. One way is through the Richard McDonald Leadership Institute, which provides leadership training for cattle industry organizations throughout the country.
Being able to really learn how to develop yourself as a better leader so that you can take that back to your states, be able to develop leaders there as well, but also to have our state leaders here attending the conference, it's an amazing opportunity for both of us. Someone mentioned that leadership, in a nutshell, is influence, and we're trying to provide influence about how to be a better leader, how to be able to really affect the beef industry from the policy, from our side, mostly from the checkoff side, but to really be able to influence people about the workings of the beef cattle industry on the state and national level.
Another option for gaining leadership skills is through NCBA's Young Beef Leader Program. The YBL program is focused on education, engagement, networking, and development of the next generation of beef industry leaders.
It's a great program. It's one we've been really excited about developing. The executive team and the leadership here at NCBA has been more supportive than we could have ever imagined, and it's something that we're really looking forward to expanding in the future.
Young Beef Leaders is a great new addition to NCBA, giving us the opportunity to get an inside look at the organization and leadership of the National Cattlemen's Beef Association. It's an opportunity to learn more about the policy side and to be involved with the leadership and be able to build that relationship and to make those friendships.
The bottom line, if you're passionate about the beef industry and want to have a hand in making it better, the first step towards leadership is to volunteer your time at any level.
Get involved on your local level and your state level with young producer programs that the states have to offer, or also maybe it's a good time to start encouraging your state to offer more young producer programs. And then once it comes to that point, come to convention. We've got a great lineup both at our annual convention coming up here in Nashville. We've got some great speakers lined up for specifically towards that millennial age group, and you'll see some webinars and some stuff coming up also based on where you're going to be seeing at convention. So it's a great time to get involved.
Because at the end of the day, this is about their bottom line. This is about their livelihood and about their legacy. So why wouldn't they want to get involved and be a part of continuing that legacy on?
Reporting from the Cattle Industry Summer Business Meeting in Denver, I'm Russell Nemitz for NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen.
To learn more about the Young Beef Leaders and other opportunities for leadership roles in the industry, visit the website beefusa.org. Still to come on Cattlemen to Cattlemen, see how some producers are baling corn stalks for use as a supplemental feed source. And later, we'll show you how some Colorado feed yards are managing lice on their operations. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Sure, cattle bring in the profits, but Case IH equipment helps you do everything else.
I've been looking all over the world.
Josh Turner here, and can I tell you how excited I am that the Cattle Industry Convention and NCBA Trade Show is coming back to Music City? It's a big deal, and Nashville is a great place for what may be the best gathering of cattle industry folks you will ever see. Why not join us? Mosey on down to Music City next February 1st through the 3rd, 2017, and I hope to see you there.
Sure, cattle bring in the profits, but Case IH equipment helps you do everything else.
Welcome back. With cattle prices and input costs where they are, producers are looking for every opportunity to make full use of all the resources that can help feed and care for their cattle. One practice that's catching on in some areas is baling corn stalks to add to the cattle forage and bedding resources available to producers. We learn more as Cattlemen to Cattlemen reporter Brian Baxter checks in from corn country in Iowa.
No doubt Northeast Iowa is corn country and cattle country too. And for Gary Hermson, his corn, cattle, and custom baling work keep him on the go every day.
As far as custom baling, I'll do anywhere from 1,500 to 2,500 bales custom work a year. And then on any given day, just like recently, I had was baling corn stalks in the afternoon. Then I switched over to waterway hay, and then I did some fifth cutting baleage for a guy, you know, all in the same day, and it worked out very well.
In much of Iowa, the trend has been toward maximizing resources and following up the corn harvest by baling the corn stalks.
Corn stalk bales in Iowa traditionally have been used as a bedding source, and not only for cattle producers, but all kinds of producers. It's a great bedding source. It's a really good bedding source from a sustainability standpoint or a systems approach, because we're removing the stalks from the cornfield, bringing that manure right back, and so we're basically recycling those nutrients. But in the last, I'll say, decade or so, we've really started to look at corn stalk bales as a feed source.
In the last 3-4 years, we've seen people add it into beef rations in the total mixed rations. As we were running short of hay in the last 2 years, then hay prices went way up. People had a ready source for corn fodder, so they would bale the corn stalks to make sure they could add it in with other energy sources, and it became a great source of fiber for the cattle.
What I see as some of the key benefits of using corn stalks in a ration is, number one, it's cheap. And with feed being at least 60% or more of our cost of production, anything we can do to cheapen up our ration is really important and really critical. So I see that as being a huge plus.
Whether used as a feed resource or for bedding, corn stalks do have real value for cattle producers. But as you might expect, there are some best practices to consider when making the move to bale corn stalks.
When producers are looking at baling at corn stalks, a couple of things I look for first, or I think you need to think about, is what's the intended use? Because that's going to make a big difference in what kind of bales or what type of bales you're going to look at. For those guys that are looking at using corn stalk bales in a cow ration, I'd probably like to prefer to have most of it be leaves and husk, because that's where our nutrient value is, versus a lot of stems. So if there's some ways we can look at picking up fewer stems and more of the leaf and husk, that's probably more ideal. In a feedlot ration, probably not as critical because it's serving the purpose of fiber only. So maybe not as critical there. And then of course, bedding sources, we really want to pick up as much product as we can.
The best way to prepare corn stalks for baling, especially with new varieties that have stay green gene in them, where the stalk is a lot greener and the ear is ready for harvest, is to take and either do flail shredding or rotary shredding of the stalks, let them dry, whatever you have for time, 3, 5, 7 days, something like that. Then come back either with a wheel rake, which is the most popular, or a parallel bar rake will work just as well. Rake windrows that are actually full width of your pickup. That way that you can drive straight down the windrow. You don't have to weave back and forth. There's less risk of you making an odd shaped bale if you actually make a nice square windrow like that that you can follow straight through.
There are several factors that influence the quality of cornstalk bales, including crop dry down, bale density, and windrow quality.
Windrow quality is really imperative with cornstalks to keep them feeding in optimally. If you want to make the maximum amount of money doing custom work for folks, you need that material to flow well. You need a nice product that's square over the top and square over the edges. Nobody likes to look at bales that are dipped in the center. They don't store as well because you get more water ingress in that area. So having a nice square-edged, flat-topped windrow is the best thing you can do for bale storage life, as well as getting the most out of your baler and tractor in a day.
I think the other thing that's really critical is that we make sure we're making dry bales. So to make sure that that product has had time to dry down so that we can store it well and get the most longevity out of it.
As far as like the density, what I really notice on the New Holland bales, as far as what my customers really like, is the fact that, you know, you got such a compact bale, whether it's 5 foot bale or 6 foot bale, it doesn't allow water in. And plus the bales hold their shape better and they store better, which makes it, you know, you have more dry matter when they go to use them. That's probably the biggest key right there.
Bale density is one key to weather resistance, and storing the cornstalk bale up off the ground is also key to maintaining quality over time.
Probably what producers would say is the biggest problem when stalk bales get wet is the ability to pick them up and use them. They tend to want to fall apart on us. I think probably the bigger effect is the loss of feed quality, the potential mold growth that comes with it. And if you're thinking about using it from a bedding standpoint, the whole purpose of bedding is to soak up moisture. If it's already wicked up a lot of moisture, we then lose a lot of our bedding effect.
For Gary Hermson, the value of cornstalk bales is clear. And when it's time to bale, for him, there's one choice when it comes to equipment and customer service.
My New Holland equipment I've got right now, I've got a T.7235 with the CVT, and I absolutely love that on front of the 560 specialty crop baler I've got, which has been a very good baler for me. My Dell Clay dealership that I bought this baler from has been very good. They're local. I like to support local when I can. And as far as, you know, if I got any questions, Jay's been more than happy to answer them for me or have somebody contact me that knows what to do. And they have good parts up there, and that's probably been the key for it.
I think that Del Clay's uniqueness with New Holland comes in the fact the way we're able to work with our area sales representative, our service representatives, to try and keep them in uptime. Uptime is important to every farmer, every operator, every business needs uptime.
As far as like the New Holland Advantage, it's a much heavier baler, and not in the terms of just raw weight, but it's how they're designed. It's designed to make a better bale because of the roll belt system. I think that's probably the key I've noticed versus just a belt baler. That's what I really like about this baler.
In Northeast Iowa, I'm Brian Baxter reporting for NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen.
To learn more about New Holland balers, you can visit their website. That's newholland.com. Still to come on Cattlemen to Cattlemen, we'll show you a tool that feed yards are using in the fight against lice. And later, we'll head to the kitchen for a can't-miss beef recipe that's bound to be a hit at your next meal. Don't go away, we'll be right back.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today. New Holland, equipped for a new world.
Want more profit out of your pasture? Then here's our 2 cents on using parasite control to make some dollars. In a trial of calves, Long Range outperformed Cydectin and Safeguard dewormers combined by as much as an extra 40 pounds. Yeah, that's a lot of extra profit. And that's why it pays to treat cattle with Long Range. Do not treat within 48 days of slaughter. Not for use in female dairy cattle 20 months of age or older, including dry dairy cows or in veal calves. Post-injection site damage can occur. These reactions have disappeared without treatment. You can't afford another season without Long Range.
The 2017 Cattle Industry Convention and NCBA Trade Show is set for Music City, Nashville, Tennessee. It's the cattle industry's biggest convention with education, networking, and fun. Plus, you can check out the huge NCBA Trade Show, outstanding entertainment, and much more. Mosey on down to Music City for the 2017 Cattle Industry Convention and NCBA Trade Show, February 1st through the 3rd. Visit beefusa.org for more.
You're watching NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen on RFD TV.
Welcome back. As we shift into the cooler months of fall and winter, it's time to start thinking about a costly concern for cattle producers, lice. Cattlemen to Cattlemen reporter Matt Fleck takes us to northeastern Colorado to learn more about methods to control what can be a pesky problem.
The USDA estimates that lice cost the beef industry about $125 million per year in losses, from decreased weight gain to property damage. What might seem like a small problem can have a huge impact.
We manage lice for a lot of reasons. Obviously, number one is for production. Number two, it's for to lower our cost on pen maintenance. Some of the things that people don't maybe realize is that constant rubbing on fences and water tanks over a period of time increases the maintenance to those facilities.
Lice is it's a big problem in our area. Every winter, late winter, we do see a crop of lice pop up and causes, what most producers see with a lice problem is that they see that they're hard on their corrals and fences. That's the first symptom we see because they're itchy. Then what comes along with that that's really hard to measure that we don't necessarily see is the production loss that we get with that. And it can be a lot more severe in younger animals, but we do see some body condition loss and loss of, I think there's a loss of feed efficiency that goes along with that, where those cows are missing hair and they're not insulated as well to our cold weather in the winter.
Lice add stress to them, which again at the bunk, it lowers their feed intake. If it lowers their feed intake, it raises their cost of gain.
Lice is a problem that typically becomes evident in the colder months of the year. The adult lice live on animals throughout the year, but really do not become problematic until they begin to laying eggs and hatching whenever the environment dictates it. Basically, what you see from a clinical standpoint, the first thing that you're going to see is animals rubbing, scratching, and you're going to start seeing a lot of destruction of property. But you can also see loss of body condition in those cows. As they do lose hair, they're less able to tolerate cold. They spend less time eating, more time scratching. And so at the end of the day, not only is it problematic from the producer from the standpoint that that person has fence to fix, but you also have an economic loss to your cow herd.
Managing lice is important to provide relief for the animals and to protect the bottom line for the operation. But in times past, control methods have varied widely in their success rate.
Traditionally in our client area, lice control programs have consisted of predominantly a generic dewormer pour on at preg check shoot. And what we've seen the last several years is a pretty poor success rate with that. So we've shifted over to, rather than pouring these cows in October, November, we're waiting until they either go to feed, winter feed, which in this area, a lot of it's corn stalks, or if they're coming home from there and timing's right, we use a product that focuses more on specific lice problems.
We just like a pour on that will control both the lice and the eggs.
One tool in the fight against lice is Cleanup 2 from Bayer Animal Health. Cleanup 2 is a ready-to-use topical pour-on with an insect growth regulator, or IGR, that works in harmony with other insecticides.
Cleanup 2 is a first of its kind, as it is a product labeled to control both biting and sucking lice, as well as the nits or the eggs that are laid by those lice. And so not only does it kill the adults, but it also kills the eggs as well, suggesting that you only have to give this product one time in order for it to be effective. Producers can use Cleanup 2 to control lice in their herds. That allows them some flexibility in that they do not have to retreat those animals, as one treatment kills not only the adults but the unhatched eggs as well. So in comparison to other products that may require two treatments, Cleanup 2 only requires one treatment.
Cleanup 2 is a ready-to-use product with a unique formulation that offers straightforward lice control in colder months. It's also a one-stop shop for diversified operations.
The formulation for Cleanup 2 is a lower viscosity formulation compared to its earlier formulation, which allows it to be easily administered in cold temperatures. Cleanup 2 is labeled to be used on both beef cattle as well as lactating and non-lactating dairy cattle, and also possesses a no pre-slaughter withdrawal period as well as no milk withhold as well.
And for the producers who are keeping a close eye on the comfort and performance of their animals every day, the results speak for themselves.
Now that there's Cleanup that actually kills the lice and the larvae, we see a really good kill on the animals at the time of pour on, and then we don't see a rehatch.
Cleanup 2 has really helped us because we have two different natural programs here, and we have conventional cattle, and just being able to use, anytime you can use one product for all three programs, we just take advantage of that.
We saw a dramatic decrease in lice population of the animal. Their hair returned back. The animals physically looked better and more content.
Better looking, more content cattle are exactly what cattle producers everywhere are aiming for. From northeastern Colorado, I'm Matt Fleck, reporting for NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen.
For more information about lice management techniques, proper use of Cleanup 2, and Bayer's other products, visit BayerLivestock.com. Still ahead, we'll check in with Baxter Black. Plus, we head into the kitchen to show you how easy it is to prepare an amazing beef meal. Stay with us.
Your buddy Ron once said he could install your ceiling fan. He couldn't. And that one time, Ron said another chili dog was a good idea? Yeah, it wasn't. So when Ron started jawing about how you'd never afford a John Deere tractor, you knew better. Now, Ron does too. Introducing the E-Series. Legendary John Deere quality. Unexpected low price. Visit a John Deere dealer today.
Mosey on down to Music City and the 2017 Cattle Industry Convention and NCBA Trade Show. It's the cattle industry's biggest convention, and there will be a special event held at the Country Music Hall of Fame. And you can't afford to miss the huge NCBA trade show.
This trade show is one of the best trade shows that is out there. And there's no other place that, for those of us as beef producers, can go to have this much information in one place.
There's no better place for cattlemen and women to learn, have fun, and connect with fellow producers from across the country.
Been able to come and relate with other producers and people within the industry to better help me prepare my farm for the future.
Plus, you can't miss another edition of the Cowboys Night at the Grand Ole Opry. So plan now to mosey on down to Music City for the 2017 Cattle Industry Convention and NCBA Trade Show, February 1st through the 3rd. Visit beefusa.org for more.
Welcome back. You know, after a long day working, nothing satisfies like a hearty beef meal. And that's exactly what we have for you today. Because today, Laura Hagen from the Beef Culinary Center is with us to tell us more about a Salisbury beef steak recipe. Is that right?
Absolutely.
Tell us more.
Okay. Well, we had a program last fall. We really wanted to work on classic beef dishes. Yeah. We wanted to make sure anybody who came to beefitswhatsfordinner.com could find something classic. We got a phone call about Salisbury steak. And I said, you know, let me double check. We had something similar, but we really wanted to recreate a Salisbury steak.
Sure.
So that we could have that available for visitors to the website.
Okay.
So this is a super simple recipe. It's done with ground beef.
Okay.
It's like basically making a burger, but putting it into a slightly football shape.
Oh, cool.
So, you know, good this time of year, football season and all of that. But basically all it is some 93% ground beef. Okay. We like to do some of the lean ground beef with a little bit of black pepper.
All right.
We form it into four kind of football shapes.
Sure.
We stick it in. This is an electric skillet. It could just go on a pan, in a pan on the stove.
All right.
And we cook them for about 10 to 12 minutes.
All right.
So flip them, make sure we get a nice color. I will often put the lid on to kind of get that cooking from within so it doesn't take quite as long.
Okay.
And then what we're going to do is basically just take all of them out. So we've got four for a serving of four.
Super.
And then this, I'm going to turn the heat on.
Okay.
We're basically going to make a simple pan sauce.
Okay.
So a simple pan sauce is really taking up this kind of good bits that are on the bottom from cooking your beef.
Mm-hmm.
I actually took a little paper towel and got a little bit of the oil off just so that we don't have any
type
of oil in there.
Sure.
But as we increase the heat, we're going to throw in our mushrooms. Which everybody likes mushrooms, I think. It's
absolutely
a great pairing with beef. We've got some diced onion.
Yeah.
Turn that up a little bit more.
Good.
And then I'm going to get those going. And
you're going to saute those before you put any liquid in.
Actually, I'm going to switch and use something that's a little easier to play with.
Super.
A wooden spoon. These skillets are great.
Yeah.
Because they really are something you can just plug in and use whether or not your burner is full or not.
Absolutely.
And I would suggest this for a really easy weeknight meal.
Yeah.
What do you think? I mean,
fun, quick, and again, a delicious meal. I just, it's a lot to... A lot better than just a burger on the grill sort of
thing. Exactly,
And in the fall to kind of...
And the nice thing is, too, that we're not using a bun, right?
Yep.
So people who have like a gluten intolerance or something like that, they can make the beef, they can make the sauce, and as long as they avoid putting anything in like that would have some sort of gluten allergen, then they're good to go.
Good to go, absolutely,
So I'm going to let this kind of continue, but what else we put in here is we put a little bit of beef stock. This is reduced sodium, so we try to keep it really... low on salt.
Right.
People considering
just a couple of cups or
this is actually about 2 cups.
Okay. Sure.
About a can. A little bit over a can. This is actually a beef bouillon granule.
Oh, really?
So it will add a little bit of salt, but it will also add another beef concentrated flavor.
Wow,
so it enables us to actually reduce this for a little bit shorter period of time.
Okay.
The other thing we're going to use that's going to really help is cornstarch.
Gotcha.
Have you ever used one of these to thicken something?
You bet.
So with this one, what's nice is we're actually able to just add it right in because as it starts heating up,
you'll keep it from getting too lumpy,
it'll keep it from getting clumpy. Yep. And believe me, I've done
clumpy gravy.
Clumpy gravy, usually what happens at Thanksgiving time, huh?
That's right.
And then a little bit of Worcestershire sauce.
Yeah, I thought that might
Worcestershire sauce has this great, great pairing with beef.
You bet.
Deep, deep fermented
type
flavor. Yep, and we're just going to continue this. I will bring it up to a boil.
Okay.
And then I will drop the heat, let it reduce for probably about 15 minutes or so, and it'll get really nice and glossy.
Gotcha.
They call them a demi-gloss for that reason.
Yeah.
They become very, very clear.
Yep.
So I'm going to show you the finished product here.
Yep.
Here is the actual sauce, so you see, just beautiful, beautiful color. And then all we do is we pair it with a favorite vegetable. That's actually just sautéed arugula, and then some mashed potato.
That looks absolutely delicious, and it smells even better. Laura, thank you so much for coming to the show. You always bring us such practical and easy recipes that even folks like I can put together. Thank you. Now, for this and other outstanding beef recipes, visit the website beefitswhatsfordinner.com or... You can always find them on our website, and that's cattlemen2cattlemen.org. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Every truck can tow a boat. Every truck can climb a hill. Every truck can haul a trailer. But not everyone can say they're the fastest growing truck brand in America. Guts, glory, Ram.
It's the official monthly publication of the National Cattlemen's Beef Association. The National Cattleman is produced exclusively for NCBA members and includes coverage of the news and events affecting our industry. Every issue includes market analysis, feature stories, and practical management tips. Start receiving your copy of the National Cattleman. Call 866-USA-BEEF or go online to beefusa.org and join today.
Let's face it, you don't think a lot about your trailer hitch. You use it and forget it. We understand. But at B&W, we think about it.
short nights, the long hauls, the never-ending chores, the unthinkable. We think about it all, so you don't have to. B&W. Trusted.
We know you're up before the dawn because the cattle rise before the sun. And you spend long hours in the saddle because the herd isn't always over the next rise. And you care for the land because you know it takes care of your family. And we know you do great work. And it's time to tell that story to the marketplace. IMI Global is here to help you do just that.
I come up this road the other day and I noticed a sign back there that said Intermittent Stream Ranch. Now I wonder whether these folks are victims of a new truth in labeling law that's been hatched by some busybody bureaucracy. I mean, could Intermittent Stream Ranch originally have been the Dry Creek Ranch or even Stuttering Brook Farms? Well, I begin to look for other names that might fall prey to these picky pontificrats. The Mile High City. Colorful, descriptive, but certainly not truthful. Truth in labeling might require Denver to rename themselves the somewhere in the neighborhood of a Mile High City. And how about the Mississippi River? Wouldn't it be more accurate if it were called the 10-State Contiguous Cooperative Drainage System and Bait Shop? Advertising a manure spreader might be less confusing if the advertiser distinguished between the person and the piece of machinery. Truth in labeling would dictate they be more specific, i.e., a bovine night soil disseminator versus a consulting economist. Does the religious right mean they're correct all the time? And the liberal left mean he's gone for good? Are the names Garden City, New York City, and Des Moines really descriptive of the town? Would a stranger pulling off Kansas Highway 50 through the wheat and the feedlot suddenly exclaim, "This town is a garden spot. This must be Garden City." In truth, New York is Old York. Now, I've never seen Des Moines in Des Moines. Why not call it Des Corns or Des Pigs? The Polled Hereford Digest. Have these people been surveyed by George Gallup or attacked by a group of maddened vultures? Better it be named the Congenitally Unarmed Hereford Digest. Truth in labeling. Once they get started, it'll never end. We'll have to change the names of the hot dog and the cowboy and the pork princess. Shoot, I might even have to change my name. How does this sound? Frontster Caucasian, livestock husbandry person versifier. This is Baxter Black from out there.
Thank you, Baxter. We'll always know who you are no matter what you call yourself. Want to rewatch an episode of Cattlemen to Cattlemen or catch up on anything you've missed? Then visit our YouTube page. You'll find replays of all of our shows filled with educational segments and producer profiles from around the country. It's also another chance to see Baxter Black. So check us out at youtube.com/cattlemen to cattlemen. We'll have more Cattlemen to Cattlemen right after this. Stay with us.
There are many great reasons to join NCBA, and that includes exclusive NCBA member discounts and benefits from some outstanding companies.
Hi, this is Kerry Bastine, president of Roper Apparel and Footwear, Stetson Apparel Boots, and Tin Hall. We are very proud sponsors of the NCBA, and for all new members signing up with the NCBA, you get 50% off your first purchase, and for all Go Forward members, you get 25% off four times a year. Go to urbanwesternwear.com, click on the NCBA specials, use your coupon code for your first 50% off, and come back to Urban Western Wear all year long and use your 25% coupons that you'll find in the National Cattlemen's newspaper.
Big discounts on boots, clothing, and Western apparel is just one of the many amazing deals you get as an NCBA member. Don't miss out. Join NCBA today and enjoy these exclusive member discounts. Find out more at beefusa.org.
Welcome back. Registration and housing for the 2017 Cattle Industry Convention and NCBA Trade Show is now open. The 120th annual convention will be held in Nashville, Tennessee from February 1st through the 3rd. Convention participants will hear from industry leaders, gather insight on industry trends, and enjoy an evening of stars and guitars at the Country Music Hall of Fame, as well as an exclusive event at the famous Grand Ole Opry. To find out all the details, including how to register online, just visit beefusa.org. I always look forward to our legacy photos segment. It's a chance to check out some treasured moments captured and submitted by farming and ranching families just like yours and mine. Let's check out this week's edition. Want to see your photo on Cattlemen to Cattlemen? You can submit your favorite shots at our website. That's cattlemen2cattlemen.org. Include your ranch or farm name and hometown, and we may use them on a future episode. Well, that's our time for this week's edition of NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you again next week right here on RFD TV.